Jew, or at least half a Jew. And after suffering under the hands of Roman governors, ever since Herod the Great's death, the Jews were enthused when his grandson, Herod Agrippa, was appointed to the throne. Now, it was about at that time, that's how the passage starts out. It was after Peter had went to Cornelius, that Roman soldier, the Gentile to whom they thought he was not supposed to go into his house, and had preached the gospel to him, and that word had been so readily received that the Gentile mission had launched and was in full swing. And the church in Antioch was thriving under the leadership of Barnabas and Saul. But we're told that at about that time, Herod, he laid hands on some who belonged to the church. Do we need to belong to the church? These did. And yet that didn't keep James from being beheaded. I mean, have you ever wondered why God allows such things to happen? You might ask, well, you know, if that's what you get for being a believer, what's the benefit? And that's a legitimate question. But another legitimate question is, why should believers have an exemption to suffering? And the answer is that we don't get one. It will touch us too. Except with us, God is with us, and we know that everything will end up working together for good. The Christian can't say, I've got an exemption, or you can't do this to me. Because they can. Why should it always be the other guys that have to suffer and never us? Arrest and imprisonment are two of the things that the world can and does do to people. You know, Joseph, Jeremiah, Daniel, John the Baptist, Jesus, Paul, they could talk to us about arrest. I've been moved by Alexander Solzhenitsyn's books, in which he describes how thousands of Russians, factory of the day of communist Russia, were taken and sent to prison camps. And as he's described that in such vivid detail, I've imagined of something of the horror that it would be. You know, one day you're free, you're living your life with the family, and the next, you're taken away. You have no rights, and you're powerless. Verse 3 says that when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter as well. He'd already had James put to death. You're under arrest. Solzhenitsyn, he'd say, those words, those faithful words changed everything. And what was the charge? You know, we're not told what these men were charged for and why they were treated as criminals. Probably they were charged with something like subversion to the public order. People who were threatened to be a threat to society. Part of Herod's motive, though, we're told, for arresting Peter, was that he wanted to please the Jews. You know, men pleasers will do terrible things. You know, they don't act according to just an internal compass of what is right and wrong. Like Pilate, Herod, he was more concerned with pleasing man than he was God, and that's a big mistake. Jesus said not to fear those who can only kill the body, but to fear him who, after he's killed the body, has the power to cast both body and soul in hell. And today, as in every generation, we need leaders who will not simply lead, you know, go by the polls, I was right. It's ironic, isn't it, that he had Peter, Peter was arrested and imprisoned during the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that annual which celebrated God's deliverance of the Jews from Egypt. But then it continued for seven days in which the Jews were to put all leaven representing sin out of their houses. And Herod, you know, he played to his Jewishness and the Jewish sentiments all he could. And here he is, he's there at Passover, celebrating the Passover like everybody else. And his house was supposed to be free of leaven. And I can imagine God doing an inspection of Herod's house and saying, "Well, what's this? Who's this imprisoned in your house?" Verse 4 says that four squads would have been 16 soldiers were appointed to guard Peter. Probably they took turns. You know, it may have been that four watched him for each of the four watches of the night. And apparently Peter had two guards in the cell with him and two outside the door at all times. I mean, you talk about not taking any chances. It brings to mind how Pilate had guards posted at the Jews' request to guard Jesus' tomb. I mean, you talk about, that's not taking any chances, right? But you know what? 10,000 soldiers couldn't have kept Jesus in the tomb. And 10,000 soldiers couldn't have kept Peter there in that prison that night. It'd be interesting to know what went through his mind, wouldn't it? You know, he'd been arrested at least twice previously and commanded not to speak anymore in the name of Jesus. But he'd said that he must obey God rather than man. And like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were thrown into the fiery furnace, Peter and the others had said, in effect, "Our God is able to deliver us. And even though if he doesn't, we will not stop speaking in his name." On at least one prior occasion, he and the other apostles were led out of prison, their prison cell, by an angel. This had happened before, and they were specifically told to keep speaking by that angel. Now, seeing as the next morning was to be his last, I wonder if Peter thought that his luck had run out, if his time was finally up. Did he think about his dear friend James, who had gotten his head chopped off? And Jesus' words to James and his brother John, that they would indeed drink the cup that he drank and be baptized with the baptism that he would undergo. Or did Peter recall that night Jesus' words to him there at the Sea of Galilee after the resurrection, how the day was coming when others would gird him, dress him, and carry him where he did not wish to go? Well, verse 6 says that Herod was about to bring him forward. Many have waited in line to meet the execution. Peter here was spared. Jesus wasn't. But apparently Peter wasn't sick with worry, because all we're told is that he slept. "Now I lay him down to sleep. I pray thee, Lord, my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray thee, Lord, my soul to take." That's one of the prayers my mom taught us to pray at the youngest age. Tell you, it makes all the difference to know whose hand your life is in. I want to read you a little account here. And this tells a story of some missionaries, and there was a ship, Zam Zam, that was sunk by the Germans in the early days of World War II. Many of the passengers were missionaries, and they ended up being picked up out of the sea by a crewman of armed German soldiers. And of course, everyone was very strained at the nerves because of that. And the passengers were separated on the basis of male and female, with the men spending the first night in one end of the ship and the women in the other. And the next morning they were permitted to come on deck and see one another. All of the expected questions of concern were asked, such as, were you nervous? Were you afraid? Could you sleep? An old missionary was asked how he managed to get through the night. And the substance of his answer was, I thought at first I couldn't possibly sleep. The floor was terribly hard, and as you know, I was very concerned and anxious. But then I began talking with the Lord. He reminded me of his word in Psalm 121. My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He shall not allow your foot to sleep. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. I was greatly struck by the words, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. So I said, Lord, there isn't really any use for both of us to stay awake. So if you're going to keep watch, I'll thank you for some sleep. And I got it, he said. Verse 7 says, and behold, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared, and the light shone in the cell. And he struck Peter's side and woke him, saying, get up quickly. And his chains fell off his hands. I said it again here recently, I'll say it again. Don't you suppose it's hard being the devil? Opposing God's purposes. No fair! They must have cried. And when Herod found out, I'm sure he said, what? But the angel suddenly appeared. You know, when God does act, it's suddenly. It's boom. A light shone. Some of you are in the cloud of gloom or despair. Chains of one kind or another hold you down. But don't give up, because for all you know, deliverance may be right around the corner. The word angel is the same word used for messenger. Hebrews 1:14 says that angels are ministering spirits sent out to render service to those who will inherit salvation. In other words, they're spirit beings sent out by God to help us. Angels on assignment is what they are. And at least one of them had the assignment of freeing Simon Peter. So the angel came suddenly. He did his job, and he was gone. Don't you suppose that we have at one time or another been delivered by an angel? Perhaps an answer to prayer. Perhaps we'll never know just how many times they've been abused on our behalf. But if, you know, it's amazing to think about it. And if they're God's messengers, what is the message? Well, the message is that God cares. The message is that we are not alone. That he is there. And know that even if God does not direct his angel to deliver, he will still be there to strengthen and help us. You know, God's angel was standing by too when James was beheaded. I know it. And anything that happens, he will allow that to happen for our good. God loved James just as much as Peter. And yet why? Why did one die and the other was delivered? We'll never know. It's all according to the mystery of his purpose. But we do know that we're not exempt from suffering in this world. But we also know that neither are we alone. Not only did Peter have the Lord through all this, he had his church family. You know, to make it, a person needs not only the Lord, but they need family. They need people that will be praying for them and support. So as you might expect, verse 5 tells us that the prayer for Peter was being made fervently by the church to God. Which you might ask the question, well, how could you go wrong then? You really can't. But note that the church, it didn't petition Herod. You know, the church didn't go out and get a bunch of signatures and waste their time petitioning Herod. No, they knocked on God's door and they made their appeal to him. And ironically, while they're doing that, while the church was knocking on God's door, Peter was knocking on theirs. It was prayer that turned the key to Peter's prison cell. Prayer turns the key. That's why Paul wrote to the church at Philippi while he was in prison. He said, I know that this shall turn out for my deliverance through your prayers and the provision of the Spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ. We underestimate the power of our prayers. The disciples back then did too, so don't worry. And they couldn't believe that God would answer that quick and dramatically. Like us, I think they probably had various scenarios worked out in their heads. And this simply wasn't one of them. And I'm comforted to think that God isn't limited to answer our prayers the way that we think he could. He's not locked into our paradigm, that there are ways outside the box that he can act. You know, Rhoda, she was awful excited. So that she didn't even open the door. Well, that's exciting. She just goes running back. It's Peter! Peter! It's Peter! And what joy there is. What joy. And God did. That was the answer. You know, JC gave his testimony last week. Again, I wasn't here to see it, to hear it. But, he and Carmel waited,
7 years.
But when God does answer, sometimes it takes forever, never, and you wait and wait. But when God does answer, what joy, what joy. And the prior pain of waiting is quickly forgotten. It shouldn't amaze us when God answers our prayers, and yet it never ceases to love us. When Peter came through the door, it must have felt a little bit like it did when Jesus first appeared after his apostles, after he rose from the dead. They had to look at him a minute, you know, and focus their eyes and tell it all soak in. Verse 17 says that motioning to them with his hand like a good preacher, right? Peter went on to describe to them how the Lord had let him out of prison. And then he went off into hiding. Apparently, they weren't able to find him. They came with him later, thankfully. Verse 18 says that there was no small disturbance among the soldiers as to what could have become of Peter. Now, Herod, he apparently didn't believe in angels. You know, because when verse 19 says that when Herod had search made and he could not be found, he wanted the heads of those guards. And don't you suppose they fought over the next assignment, over who got to guard the apostles next time? Not. He couldn't be big enough to take that job. Psalm 31 tells us not to fret ourselves because of evil doers, nor to be envious of them. Herod, you see, he lived a pretty privileged life. And he never suffered much in this lifetime, at least not at the hands of others. But would you want to trade places with him? He died a terrible death. And it came to a miserable end, eaten of worms. You know, and as I mentioned to the Wahlbergers, you need to understand, if you don't, that God means business. And that he holds the power of life and death. morning, and there is a message, and that is, you're not alone. Never have been, and never will be. Peter had two guards in the cell with him, but God's angel was also there. Therefore, and he didn't even know the angel was there, he slept. He had peace. May God also give you the ability to rest in him and to sleep while you wait on him to do it. And some of you have been such great examples to me. And I would say, Pastor, I know. I know that the answer's coming. I know that God's already given it. I'm just having to wait, and I wait with you. Let's wait with one another. Leaving in and trusting him. He delivered Peter from death, at least this time. Later, from what we can tell in history, Peter did lose his.